go. You just have to wait for the lift to go, and the other doctor will know that. But typically, I'd say from 30, 45 minutes to an hour, just depends on the doctor. You know, we have a lot of doctors outside who interview for us, outside practicing physicians, and a lot of times it just depends on that doctor, because I've heard students say, gosh, he's the nicest man in the world. He wanted to come to his house on Sunday, he and his wife prepared me a meal. I was there for like 4 hours. So it just depends on the doctor. But I'd say 30, 45 minutes is usually an hour max. All right, so those are all important, but this is equally important. Your letters of recommendation, so you want to make friends with faculty, somebody who knows you, somebody who can write great things about you. Leadership, take part in lots of things while you're here, and try to assume a leadership role. That can be within Clemson, it can be within the church, it can be in the community, anything like that, but that's something that's, again, we're sort of rating and see how you've done. These last two, of course, volunteering, any kind of charitable works, shadowing clinical exposure tests. So probably of all those, the thing that would keep you out of notice from death is if you don't have that last, actually any of those would keep you out. But if you have a shadow or have some kind of clinical exposure medicine, you're not going to get noticed. It just is, it's a given. You just can't. Because we can't take the chance that you're going to come in and really know that that's what you want to do unless you spend a good bit of time doing it. And we talked earlier in the class, if your father's a physician, grandfather, mother, whatever, if the only person you've ever shadowed is that family member, that's not good either, because that doesn't show that you've really sort of opened yourself up to experiences. Because that means like anybody can just shadow their father or their mother or somebody. But get out there and try to shadow different kinds of doctors. And then the other thing that can make a difference in somebody's application is if you have any kind of added value. And for us, we're looking for students, as we interview, to say these students have some unique qualities that we find desirable for our students in USC. These are some of the ones that are considered, but again, we can't have just lists. The people who interview, you can even say, this student has done amazing things in this, or whatever, I'd recommend him or her for added value. These are some of the most frequent ones that you see the students may get some added value, which is extra points in the process. Cultural experiences, diversity, that's underrepresented in medicine, or that could be your families in the military, you grew up in China or Vietnam, or you speak a different language, they'll look at that. Any kind of significant research, that's not typically books. Undergraduate. That's like you got your PhD and you've authored papers and something like that. Or it could be a master's degree, but it's a terminal degree. It's not, I'm working on my degree. Well, after you get your degree, you get that on added value. Overcoming adversity, overcoming a disability, any kind of significant artistic or athletic achievements. If you're a varsity, you can play any kind of varsity sport, you're going to get added value for that because it shows that you can be team, you spent lots of time doing something else as well as doing well in your studies, but you could also be a member of a choral group or symphony or where you had to do a lot of maybe traveling, playing outside of the campus. They would look at you for added value for that. And then someone asked me earlier, what if I just didn't do well the first year, but I've really made better grades throughout, and that's another thing. It's a way to not forgive, but on the back end, give you some added value for the fact that you really started out slow, but you come back strong. And then the last is somebody who's been out working for a number of years. They can get added value for their maturity and what they've been doing, over the course of time since they graduated from college. So at the very end, if you look, this is our index. And it really is the only ones we talk to applicants all the time. You'll say it's a numbers game. And unfortunately, everything that's put in, it really is, how you rank. And whether you get in is based on this formula. So 25% your adjusted GPA, 25% your destiny index score, 25% the three, those average three doctors coming together, rating you on a scale of 1 to 10 of all those traits, your average of all those three interviews, and then the other 25% is the average of those accomplishments, which is your letters of recommendation, your leadership, your volunteers, your clinical exposure to medicine, gives us a final number. And so to that final number, just say, and I like to just, so y'all understand, just say if the admissions committee is accepting every student at a 12.5, if you end up with a 12.0, there could be 50 or 60 students in between you in the 12.5, because you're separated by hundreds of points on this list. Well, if you had a graduate degree, admissions, the committee said, let's give the student 0.5 for a graduate degree. Instead of a 12.0, you're now in a 12.5 and you're a medical student. If you didn't have that added value, you're not a medical student. Now, does everybody have to have added value to get medical student? Of course not. You know, if you have a good MCAT, good grades, your interviews are great, as well as your accomplishments, you're in medical school. I mean, you don't have to worry about it. But just say if you had a 27 on the MCAT. This year, our average is 39. And that's a weakness in that second part of this formula. And no matter how your GPA might be a 3.7, the interview tracks, those might be really good if you don't get in. But if you have something significant that gives you added value, you could possibly get in. Now, everybody who gets added value does not get in. You might have a 10.8 and you get 1.0 or something. You might get two things for added value. You've got 11.8 short here. But when you come to talk to me and you say, well, did the admissions committee look at my graduate degree? Yes, they did. They gave me added value for that. Did they look to see that I was from a rural county in South Carolina? Yes, and you've got added value for that. It still wasn't enough to overcome whatever else might have been directed. The students can understand when they don't get in, why they didn't get in, and what they can work on. It's a very transparent system. And unfortunately, this year, I predict a lot of students coming to talk to us. It was such a competitive year that I just think of, in another year, like last year or year before, some of the students would have gotten in if it had been 2009 or 2008. This was an incredibly competitive year. Not only were the numbers higher, but everybody who applied just seemed to have amazing scores and grades and everything else. And so a lot of times people say, it's not just about grades, no, it's not. We still just have everything else too. So this is kind of why right now I've put a little asterisk saying we're finalizing the class. We're sending out the letters on the alternate list. We're seeing how many people. So right now, with 155, this is how it will look. I think right now there's probably, it might be a little bit different. So this is the numbers from last year, 155. And these numbers on the bottom, this is what right now you're looking at to be competitive and get medical school. The average GPA, this is unadjusted, 3.67. The ranges are 2.97, but if you see somebody with a GPA under a 3.0, they have a graduate degree with a higher GPA. Anybody who comes to talk to me, their GPA is 2.7. I don't care if they have a 32 on the MCAT. That 2.7 is probably going to keep them out of medical school unless they have graduate work that can overcome some of the lower grades. The average MCAT score right now is 30.62, which translates into 31, and the MCAT ranges from 21 to 38. Now, 21 is the absolute lowest MCAT we'll ever look at, and very few people get on the 21. You have to have a 4.0 GPA almost with a high adjustment as well as everything else in the great range to get in. But that's the lowest score that we feel like students can come in with and pass the board. And so that's where we keep it in. Duke has that as their threshold number also. I was amazed when you were talking earlier about Hazy Martin, she said Brown University doesn't even look at it.
It's one of the very few medical schools in the country that doesn't even look at MCAT.
I know
all of you are in a rush to apply to Brown.
But I would also say
unusual.
I bet they look at SAT scores. I don't think it'd be in their formula, but I bet they look to say this student scored a 13-15 on the SAT. It's kind of like years ago when we had the early acceptance program, where students can be sent straight out of college. Well, we didn't require the MCAT either, but we would have had it. But anyway, that's unusual. I mean, that's amazing. This is our underrepresented in medicine. And I think right now, we had 29 last year. I think right now there's 31 students who were accepted in the medical school. And these are students who were accepted. And you see, Clemson always has the largest number of students who were accepted into our class. The three biggest was in USC and College of Charleston kind of fluctuate every year. USC last year had 27, College Charleston had 18. Some years it's like College Charleston has 25, USC has 27. But anyway, Clemson always has more, always, which is great. But even the school as little as Wofford, look at that, Wofford had 10 as soon as she started. So I only listen to students here if we have two or more from a college. We have lots and lots of colleges that we have one from. And so students come from all over. It doesn't matter, you know, to us. New students and new students. And in that, y'all don't really care so much about, but the Board of Trustees always wants to make sure that we accept students from every county. They think in Charleston County, you take everybody from Charleston. We really do not take everybody from Charleston. And a lot of these students, 27, who say Charleston, they establish residency because they've been working in Charleston for a number of years. And so that's kind of, that's our admission process. And again, the one thing I want to caution all of y'all, when you apply to an MCAT, it's very important when you fill out your application, number one, you're going to have to write a personal statement. And that takes students a while to write. And most students are going to write in that statement, write it on their medical school or something to that effect. But don't make that statement so bizarre that everybody who reads it is like, this is weird. You don't want to be weird. A little bit creative, wonderful, but not strange. And so yet, Dr. Smith, get your pre-medic file. I know you can't read everybody's personal statement, but get an English professor, somebody that you know and trust, to read that statement. And you are asking just for them to change it. Just say, will you read this and make sure it sounds like a medical school essay should sound. And because if you get lots of people to read it, I can tell you, somebody's getting theirs one time. And said, when you read this and let me know how it sounds. Well, he sent it to like five other faculty. And everybody told him something different. And I'm like, oh, no, no. You know, the basic concept's wonderful. But his was really wordy. I mean, it just went on and on and on and on. And I'm like, that's too much. But other people were telling him, throw in stuff about this and throw in stuff about that. It's like, no. So go to one person that you really trust. Say read this, and if they say, you know, it's just a little bit off, you want to change it. You don't want something that's not. And the other thing is, make sure when you fill out this, there's a section on experiences. You may not think it's important to put something in there, but it's better to have it in there and not need it than to need it and not have it. And so a lot of students are humble and they don't feel like they need to put everything that they don't want to brag. But like Dr. Edwin says, this is the time you've got to brag yourself. You've got to put things in there that you've done so that when your interviewers interview you, they can read what you've done. And one of the things I'll use for an example, if you're an Eagle Scout, put it in there that you're an Eagle Scout. That's a big deal. You had to do a lot of work to be an Eagle Scout. And there are students who just say, I thought you only wanted things when I was in college. Well, most of them do, but something that's major like that, you've got to put it in there. And so do fill out that application to the best of your ability, but don't just think maybe I want to include that. It's better to include it than not to include it. Because that is what we're going on when we look at your application until we can interview you. So it's important. So I think that's the process. And the sad thing is, like I said earlier, everybody doesn't need medical school. But right now, we've sent out all the letters saying we're not going to be here. We've sent out the letters saying we're on the alternate list. We never know from year to year how many students are going to make it from the alternate list because we don't know who's going to actually withdraw from us between now and when school starts. But I can tell you, the students who are on that alternate list, we are calling for them. We want people to withdraw.